dankjewel, dankjewel.
Dankjewel.
Dankjewel, publiek hier in Groningen in EMG Factors, waar topnemers de hele dag actief is om interviews te doen met prachtige ondernemers uit deze wonderschone stad. Richard Kastelein, what do you say, Richard Kastelein?
I say Richard Kastelein, like a fishing line, you know, Kastelein.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's, most English speaking people can't
But you have,
a
very Dutch family.
Yeah, yeah, my oma and opa, my grandparents came with like 12 kids after the war to Vancouver, so I grew up in Canada. My father was Canadian, my father's Dutch and my mother's Canadian, so.
Okay, you live in Haren.
I live in Haren, yeah.
Okay.
Of all places, yeah. Project X. Everybody knows Haren, it's amazing. Haren, sorry. Yeah, oh, my sister even knows where Haren is. It's the only other, you know, because of the Project X. And
yeah. So, what do you do here?
Well, I'm an expatriate. I moved here from the Netherlands Antilles, actually, just after the turn of the millennium. And I'm an entrepreneur, so I've worked with some startup in Groningen, World Ticket Shop, for a few years. But I've since gone on, and I've been through about 6 startups, and been through 5 failures, which is a badge of honor in Silicon Valley. But in the Netherlands, it's not necessarily something I talk about in the pub very much. You know, in San Jose or in Silicon Valley, I'd be like, yeah.
They always say that, but I always also think that that is in a jokingly way. But is it really true that in Silicon Valley, you know, you are proud to fail?
Yeah, because actually other startups look at that as failure as something that's positive, because you go through the failure experience and you learn from that experience. And I've been lucky. I've been through quite a few failures, but all I've lost was what we call sweat equity. I didn't lose money. I never went bankrupt, but I wasted a lot of time, you know, many hours of the wee hours of the morning thinking, oh, I got to add another 20 pages to this 180-page business plan and we'll get the money and, you know.
Yeah, but you said 6 startups, 5 failures. Yeah. The successful one was Hackfest.
Yeah, I started...
had a successful exit recently.
I had a successful exit in 2013, yeah.
Yeah, explain us what kind of company that is.
Well, I started off 4 years ago, and that's, I believe, how we met, Roland. Yeah. I started off writing about future television.
Yep.
And I hadn't any experience in the television arena, but I just decided that that small niche area needed covering, because I thought the internet's going to collide with television and all this mayhem is going to come, and I'm going to be there as part of it, documenting it. Part of that process was a lot of startups coming to me because I was writing about stuff that was interesting to them.
It was about connected television.
Connected television, social TV, second screen, transmedia, all these new movements. And then I started seeing more SDKs and APIs coming in, and I thought, you know what? I think TV's ready to be hacked.
Yeah.
So I decided to start the first television hackathon in London in 2012, and within 3 months, I'd sold the brand to an events company in the UK, and we ran television hackfests in London and San Francisco for 2 years. And we ran Health Hackfest, machine to machine. We're going into other verticals. For anyone that doesn't know what a hackathon is, it's really just a short-term innovation event where we tool everybody up with great kit to build stuff. And we put people from different disciplines together who aren't usually together. Like in Brussels, we put together health professionals with coders. And in TV, we put together producers and writers with coders. And we give them a couple days to mix it up and come up with stuff. And it's gamified. So they win a prize. They get a great jury of, you know, industry-leading people who select them or not select them. And so we've had some great success stories. Some of our hacks have actually gone on to get funded and also gone right to market.
Okay. 4 years ago, you were convinced that television was ready to be hacked. Mm-hmm. People sometimes also call you a futurist. I don't know exactly what it is. But if you look at our present day, which developments do you see that are of interest to you at the moment?
Well, I think that, you know, when I look at the value chain in television, for instance, it's quite interesting to compare that to what happened in music. And with my experience here with the World Ticket Shop in Groningen, was in the music industry, and I saw quite closely how disruptive the internet was to that industry, you know, straight from, you know, before Spotify started making money for the artists. They really went through 5 years of nothing, and their whole industry was disrupted. They had to go on tour again, you know, a lot of bands from the 80s and stuff. And then in television, we're facing a lot of the similar issues. I mean, television is funded, largely commercial television is funded by commercials.
Yep.
And 30-second spots are something that people don't really like. And that's statistically proven, even though that's not talked about very much. The fact of the matter is that's what funds television for the large part. And, you know, when people start using these devices and tablets in front of the television now, which probably 60% of all people in the Netherlands are doing daily, they're being distracted from that 30-second.
85 already.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah.
So they're being distracted from those 30-second spots. So if they're not watching those 30-second spots for the greater part, then the brands are noticing that and the agencies are noticing that. And that is really making their commercials less effective. So therefore, you know, not only are the numbers going down in terms of overall reach, NBCU in the U.S. can't even get 5 million people to watch a show anymore. You know, 5 or 6 years ago, 5 million people would barely push through a pilot. So they don't have that reach anymore, that massive reach, as we move from a world of one-to-many to a many-to-many world where many, many people are broadcasting to many participants. It's becoming democratized in a sense. So that's some of the stuff that I talk about usually. Is I talk about what happened in print, what happened in music, and why I believe we have to look at what happened in those two other industries and say, well, here's what could happen in television, and how are we going to deal with that? How are commercial broadcasters and public broadcasters going to deal with this Leviathan shift in the market?
At the same time, one of the most interesting things you told me recently was that you are helping the European Union with a startup fund of 80 billion
euro, billion with a B. That's a lot of money for startups, but it's not all for SMEs.
I understand that you are saying
I'm looking at probably, you know, so 5 or 6 startups a week.
Okay.
It's really a privilege for me.
Do you all know his telephone number?
Just say, hey, Rich, give this a thumbs up. It's really a privilege for me. I'm quite honored to have the experience of seeing so many startups.
Exactly which program is that?
I'm doing, Neely Cruz, she's really behind the whole program. She's done a great job. And I'm doing a lot of the SME work. So they're giving out 50,000 euro to startups for their feasibility studies. So, you know, and don't be afraid of the paperwork anymore. It's not as crazy as it used to be. The last funding round was called FP7. It was also 6 years, but it was crazy. You had to fill out form after form. I mean, how much toilet paper did you lose this week? And, you know, it's just crazy. It was too much. But they've taken a lot of that out. So there's also another program called Eurostars, which is a bit higher up. So what they do is if you go through the feasibility study stage and you keep progressing, then you're looking into the millions after that. So I'm also doing the same thing for the UK Technology Strategy Board in the UK. I wish they were doing this in the Netherlands, but in the United Kingdom, the TSB is giving away £30 million to creative industry startups. So that's a lot around TV and around media, which is more my area. But
is subsidizing startups a good idea?
I think so, yeah. I think especially for those, it's different between the TSB, they want us to fund things that aren't necessarily totally commercial or have commercial, huge commercial impact, but they want us to fund things that could have game shifting, you know, industry changing potential. They're really happy for us to explore those areas of virtual reality and things that don't get funded normally through VC. Or I would say it's more interesting for a lot of companies to look at those funding sources rather than, you know, stick your neck out to the VCs and let them, you know, come in and basically take it all, you know, it create a very difficult financial.
Yeah, but it's good that you say that, because normally when I hear stories like this, I think, oh, a lot of paperwork, don't do it. But you say, that changed.
Well, and it also, you know, as a startup person myself, working on a startup now, I think the process of going through that is good. You know, going through that process of having to pitch, you know, say, I don't know, 1,500 words, a few pages to the EU or the European Commission to get money helps you also put into perspective what you're doing. And it gives you a framework to think about what you're doing a little bit. So even if you don't get the money, I think the process is still useful. And it's not really stupid anymore like it used to be. Like, they don't need to know that. They really got it down to asking the things that they should know, not everything. So
I take a question from Twitter.
Sometimes we need a little time to think.
No problem.
Jarno, was a guest at our table. He you told about that a few minutes ago about the health hackathon. He's asking you if you have some examples of the startups that got funded from the health marathon.
Well, we haven't seen
health hackathon.
It's only been recent now because it's only a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
But we one of the API providers was a company called Sensum.io, who's a very interesting UK startup that basically allows. They built a database around barcodes.
Yeah.
In terms of connecting, so it's connected with the FDA, so you can get a lot of information about food. So one of the startups was you could scan something in the supermarket and compare it to your medication to make sure that you're eating food that's applicable to, you know, that's safe for you,
yep.
Which I thought was really interesting. And another one was to do with allergies, so you're allergic to certain things. But honestly, I mean, it was, who knows if they're going to get funded, because really, realistically, you know, the guy who did the one for, you know, against your medication, he had Google glasses on, of course, and he was scanning everything with his glasses. It's a bit far-fetched. I mean, how many people are actually really going to scan something in a supermarket to make sure? But, you know, we're entering, these are the kind of ideas that are great to explore. I mean, even if they're not realistic, they may not seem realistic now, they could be something in 5 years from now that's...
If you look at the kind of startups that ask for funding at the European Commission, are the European countries equally distributed there or present? Or
I mostly see actually Belgian, German, and Dutch.
Okay.
Mostly.
Yeah.
So basically Northern Europe, yeah. I mean, England, Belgium, Holland.
But in general, if you look at those startup cultures and the activities in mm-hmm. that area, you're in England, you're in Brussels, you've been in America a lot. How do you compare the different worlds and the focus people have or the subjects they deal with or are interested in?
I'm really excited about two places in Europe. One is Berlin and the other is London.
Mm-hmm.
I'm kind of warm on Holland, but I think they could do better.
And then why are you excited about it?
Well, the UK, for instance, is just pumping enormous amounts of money and really pushing East London as a tech culture. And they call it the Silicon Roundabout.
Yep.
And it's just amazing what's happened in the past 5 years. The government realizes, well, they're not making stuff anymore. But what England does have is a huge wealth in innovation. They've always been a very innovative nation, as is Holland and as is Germany. But they've decided to really, you know, push it and you know, not perfectly, certainly, but they've really done a lot of work in creating a strong startup culture and inviting people from outside London. So a lot of EU startups are going there as well, and there's a lot of connections to Silicon Valley, English, you know, the natural yep. language connection, but also other things. I think the Netherlands is also very strong. I think it's interesting, but you know, some of the things of Dutch culture, I think, could do with some changing. One is
okay.
certainly the.
Okay,
the
there
Well, well, not for startups, for yeah. startups, not overall, people, I promise. But for startup culture, I think that, you know, I think that the failure thing has to be addressed. And I think that's something even Neelie Kroes talks about a lot over all of Europe. But, you know, it's certainly part of Dutch culture,
But is that a culture thing? Or is that a thing that, say, over here, when you end up with a company with a lot of debt, etc., you can't, say, just stop and start again? But, well...
They're trying to change the legislation.
Thing, or is the culture?
It's both. It's a legislative issue. So if you go bankrupt and you owe lots of money to creditors, you can't start a business again.
Yeah.
Really? Well, you can if you want to go to England and open a company there, or Germany and do it again somewhere else. It's not that hard anymore. I mean, your life isn't ruined because of that. But I think they're also trying to address that on a legislative point of view from the European Union as well. But I think also culturally too. You know, like I said. It could be kind of that North American thing, I guess. I mean, I come from North America, so it's a bit that kind of, you know, the Wild West. And, you know, I mean, the people have had to kind of eke their living out of the land. And there's this real entrepreneurial kind of spirit in their culture that is a little bit different than Europe.
Yeah, but you were going to mention more elements of what we could do better here. This was one of them.
I think that certainly that was one of them. I think also, funny enough, a lot of startups I've been involved with, they really adhere to this like 9-to-5 kind of old rigid Dutch cultural show up for work, don't leave at 5, leave at 5 after 5, you know, you got to be there. And I found that a bit strange. I loved how Opera worked in Norway, for instance. It's quite a large company, maybe 1,500 staff, but everybody has to be there between 10 and 2 for meetings. And then they can work from in the morning till 10 at home, or from 2 till, you know, they trust their employees. They empower their employees. They say, look, you know, you guys are adults. And actually, if you look at the statistics of businesses, and I've seen a really great video from the Royal Society of Arts on this, but actually, people work harder when you give them more freedom because they feel a bit guilty. You know, they're like, oh, I'm at home, I better really, you know, and then they have to justify what they're doing a little bit more rather than sitting around the office.
Yeah.
So I think that...
That's a tradition, cultural thing, of course, that's hard to change.
That is hard to change, but I think it would be interesting if they could.
Amongst young people, it's already very different at the moment.
Yeah. Well, my CEO, one of my CEOs was 26.
Okay.
And doing, you know, doing very well here in the Netherlands with 50 staff, and it wasn't very different.
Okay, Paul Schuren wants to know, he's telling that soon there is an e-health hackathon in Groningen. Mm-hmm. Are you involved in that too?
No.
Okay.
Well, I've talked with Jarno about doing one here.
Okay.
Based on, you know, on what was happening, because I would really love to do something in Groningen. And I know that, for instance, IBM is just, you know, they recently opened up an office here and created 350 jobs. So I'm really happy to see that there's a strong developer community here. And I think, whoever's doing it, I wish them the best of luck. And I would like to contact them and give them all the help I can.
Yeah. Okay. I did some voting on Twitter. And most people with Jarno in the lead wants you to tell us more about the future of television. We started the discussion with that. And then we ended by saying that if you look at the music industry and you make that comparison, that the television as we know it is coming to an end slowly.
I think we're moving from a one-to-many to a many-to-many paradigm.
That's what you said, yeah.
And I think that there's a lot of reasons for this, but if you look at the music industry, one of the great powerful movements in the music industry today is called direct-to-fan. So that means, like, why does Rihanna need Ticketmaster, a promoter, a manager, a label, and this daisy chain of people between her, the creator of content, and those who consume it? Why does she need Ticketmaster to sell tickets when she could just say, I'm having a concert in Groningen, buy your tickets here on Facebook, and all 70 million of her fans see it? I mean, this whole value chain that existed before is kind of being sucked away. And I think that, funny enough, I do believe in the future we'll see more of that in the audiovisual industry as well. And that sounds strange because most of the time when you watch television, the production company behind what you're watching, you don't know who they are. You don't know who Endemol is, or you don't know who Fremantle.
Nobody cares.
Well, that's interesting. They don't care. And All3Media, though, which is the largest independent production company in the UK, has now gone to the US market with a connected TV application with their content, and they're calling it the best of Britain. So this is one of the first times that an actual production company has branded itself as a provider of content directly to consumers. So
no, but there are more production companies doing that. In the Netherlands, Blue Circle is starting like digital channels on horse riding and on all kind of subjects.
Yeah, and that's direct to fan, more or less.
Yeah, what is personally intriguing me are the multi-channel networks on YouTube.
Machinima, amazing.
They're really, they're exploding in terms of reach and viewers and subscribers, and also in the portion of advertising money they are attracting from the big brand.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know who the largest, Machinima, right?
Yep.
It's the largest, one of the largest networks on YouTube, 10,000 channels, 40 billion views.
40 billion, huh?
Yeah, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. I talk about Machinima usually to broadcasters and they have no idea.
They don't even know it exists.
Yeah. But you know the weirdest thing about Machinima? You know who the largest advertiser is? The US military, which I'm not surprised, but it's also a bit weird because it is all a bunch of, Generation Y, Generation Z, millennial, young lads showing off their shooting skills, their gaming skills.
Earlier on you said what is changing is that the people don't want to see the 30-second ads anymore.
I believe the 30-second spot is dead for everything but live.
Yeah, so what's coming instead of it?
Well, I think the only advantage that commercial broadcasters and public broadcasters currently have is the fact that they own the rights to a lot of live content or event-driven content, which is interesting, like The Voice. And these are certain genre that they will have to grab as a market because that's all they will have. I mean, when you have Netflix and you have video on demand services propping up everywhere and people love to binge, why should they, you shouldn't have to be locked to an electronic program guide telling you what you want to watch, when you're supposed to watch it. I mean, that's going to be non-existent in 10 years for sure. I mean, other than live. Live and event-driven television will be their bread and butter of the future. But if that can buy the rights, especially for sports, because, if Google decides to go into the next round of sports auctioning for television rights, they can outbid anybody. Rupert Murdoch, you know, forget those guys. And, they're not even in the same league. And Google actually owns the cricket rights in India. A lot of people don't know that.
They own the international cricket rights.
Yes.
And what you see already now is that in the niche sports that you cannot actually make profitable in one single country, YouTube is already buying the rights and exploiting them on a global level. So it's sports for the traditional channels right now. Big entertainment with
live, event-driven.
With an interactive element in it.
Yeah.
You know, second screen, voting, watching it together with your whole family on a Friday night. Is there more?
I think, and news, of course.
Breaking news.
Yeah, breaking news. That's something that, you know, and political debates and live,
elections,
things like that. Yeah,
kind of
exactly,
stuff.
That kind of stuff. But for the rest of it,
no.
I don't believe that there's...
So we have in Holland at the moment, we have, I think, 12 linear channels or something like that?
Yeah, I mean...
How many will...
Broadcasters always ask me, well, where's the money going to come from?
Yeah.
Who's going to pay for this?
Yeah.
And that's interesting because the brands have traditionally paid for that really through their agencies, right?
Yeah.
Now, if you look at... What's interesting is I've been to MIP, you've been to MIP TV quite probably in the past in Cannes,
yep.
which is the world's largest content trading show. And you go into MIP and you see that there's Red Bull there. Red Bull's a brand. They're selling over 2,000 episodes of their own content.
They're a media company.
They're a media company that sells drinks. That's what I call them. So, I mean, now we're seeing all kinds of cross-channel movement as well. I mean, even in the audiovisual side, you have, like we talked about, production companies now moving into becoming broadcasters, really.
Yep.
You know, and we've seen that in the media industry. Print industry as well. The Guardian is now doing video, for instance. So there's a lot of shifting and moving around, you know, certainly in all the three major areas of entertainment that have been affected, music, print, and video.
Exciting. Yeah.
Yeah, it's an exciting time, and that's why I went into television in 2010. I thought stuff is going to happen here, and I'm really excited about it, and I really want to be part of it. So,
if you look at your own behavior, do you have what are you watching? You have Netflix, I guess.
Yeah, you know, I'm not really a second screen guy.
Buying movies on iTunes.
No,
downloading illegally.
I've done that in the past. Yeah, in the early days.
Like when you were young.
Yeah, when I was young. Don't sue me, please. But I'm quite a normal user. I mean, I will second screen, but like most people, I don't really associate it with the television show. So I'm doing Twitter or something else. It may not be related. And I'm not so sold on the second screen, especially for drama. You know, we can go into that conversation too, but I think it's really difficult to write shows that incorporate real-time synchronous engagement with television, especially in the drama realm.
Well, I think it's a very interesting story about the future of television. I see a lot of people getting really thirsty, I think. Do you have any other questions for Richard?
No, because it's a subject we could talk
for hours.
For hours. So let's
about,
do
yeah.
let's do that definitely another time.
Yeah,
and this was very interesting. Both your views on startups and on television.
Thank
so,
you.
Thank you very much.
Cheers.
Dan danken we jullie ontzettend, maar natuurlijk niet nadat we nog één keer bedankt hebben. Dat hebben we deze hele dag al gedaan. Jullie kennen het rijtje inmiddels. EMG Factors die deze prachtige locatie verzorgen. Streamzilla al 3 jaar lang onze streaming. Provider, Voice, de aanbieder van zakelijke telefonie, Social Media Club Groningen, het Mercure Hotel, de NOM en achter de NOM de Europese Unie, het Europees Fonds voor Regionale Ontwikkeling en de provincies Drenthe, Groningen en Friesland. We danken jullie allemaal thuis en we danken jullie allemaal hier. Tot de volgende keer.
Dankjewel.